Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Happy New Year and welcome to 2016. We're still early in this year, but we're back as always to talk about Flames hockey. Matt, how was your holiday?
And nice to get a little bit of a break, and it's also nice to get back and covering Flames hockey.
Yeah, it was a fairly restful holiday for most people I've talked about. I think most people had part of, if not the whole week between Christmas and New Year's off this year, and I know I did, and it was really nice just sit around and do nothing and watch a lot of Flames games. It's been sort of a weird week for the Flames. They had their game, you know, right after Christmas, and then they had some time off in there, and you could definitely tell that the Christmas break was affecting them. I mean, they played on the 22nd, then the 23rd, 24th, 25th, 26th off. They played against the Oilers, they played the Ducks, and they pretty much had a good pace of playing pretty much every other day after that, but you could tell that the 4 days started to affect them later on. Let's look at those games. The first game we played, the one I was most excited about this year, was, again, having the Oilers against us. And thankfully, I'm never sure these days what to expect from the Battle of Alberta, but thankfully, after the Oilers got up 2-0, we ended up beating them 5-3. Any thoughts for you on this one, Matt?
Well, you knew that as soon as the Flames scored that shorthanded goal by Matt Stajan, that the Flames were going to win. And the Oilers, any adversity they face, they fold like a cheap tent. They're, once again, they're the second worst team in the NHL, third worst team in the NHL. It is what it is. They're not a very good team. And until they make changes in personnel all throughout the lineup, they're going to remain as terrible of a team as they have been. Connor McDavid can't save
them. To me,
them.
I think that this was an interesting game because I looked at it as a game of mistakes. Both sides were making mistakes. The Flames made some early, Edmonton made some, and both sides, I thought, were able to capitalize on each other's mistakes. They were able to, you know, take advantage when the other team made a mistake, and I think that's part of the reason it was such a high-scoring game that we saw here. One of the things I really liked in the sort of the beginning of the second period was the Flames' net presence. They had really good net presence. They were really putting, and we saw it when TJ Brody almost scored there at the beginning of the second, but we were really starting to see this team, you know, playing in front of the net. As you mentioned, it's easier to do in Edmonton because they're not a good team. They don't have a lot of defense at all there, but we're seeing them, I thought, play quite strong in front of the net.
Yeah, and the new term is the home plate in front of the net. And the Flames seem to, when they are successful in winning games, they're getting a lot of pucks into that area and taking shots, making passes, and all that stuff. If they're going to be successful, that's the area that they need to be in the most.
I thought that second period in that game up to that point was perhaps one of the most exciting Flames periods that we saw to that point in the season. Just having as many goals as they got 4 goals in that period. And just the way they were playing, I don't know about you, but I was quite amped up watching that period.
Yeah, I agree. The only other game that I can recall was that San Jose game a couple weeks ago against in the Salad Dome. They had a similar second period that game. They played really well.
And I think for the first time this year, we could probably argue that the Flames won the special teams battle.
Yeah. Well, that's been a problem all year. It's been getting better recently. The Flames are actually scoring on the power play now, which was something that was pretty much missing the entire month of
Well,
December.
That Matt Stajan goal in the second was the Flames' first shorthanded goal of the whole year, I believe.
Mm-hmm. And I think last year we had 6 or 7 shorthanded goals. So.
And also the first time this season that we've scored 2 power play goals in one game. Both of Gio's goals were on the power play.
Yeah, I think up until that Oilers game, the Flames only had 10 or 11 power play goals all season. So it's not exactly been a very big strength for the Flames.
No, but it's good to see, even if it's against the Oilers, sort of in a tune-up game, if you will, of saying, okay, we've got that rolling. We've got our shorthanded goal. You know, we can do more than one power play goal. Now let's see that roll over to the other games. So I thought if it's going to happen, it might as well happen against the Oilers. And it did. We got our first shorthanded goal of the year. And good to see them winning. As you mentioned, it's been a weakness. Good to see them winning some of the special teams competition.
Yeah. Anytime a team has the 30th ranked power play and penalty kill, usually that team is so far in the basement that, you know, they could go on a 10-game winning streak and they'll still be in last. So the fact that the Flames are working on it to improve it, that will help, especially considering where the Flames are in the standings. If they can even improve to 25th or higher by the end of the year, that will help the Flames move closer to clinching a playoff spot.
I don't know about you, but I thought he was only named the third star of the game, but I thought this might have been Bennett's best game of the year.
He has been playing significantly better. He struggled for a long, long, long stretch of the season, pretty much since the Anaheim game at the end of November. And, yeah, he's starting to engage more physically, and when he is engaged, he is playing
better.
He's
looking like the Sam Bennett we saw last year in the postseason.
Yeah. It's one of those situations where if he gets a fluky goal, and you got to figure that eventually with how many quality chances he's been throwing at net lately, that one of them eventually will go in. You could see him going on like a 10-game goal streak or something like that immediately following. He's starting to do all the right things and getting the parts of his game that he has been struggling with ironed out. It's just not clicking for him still.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think we're going to see him break out very shortly here and start to see, you know, him, I think, make more of an impact. He's still a rookie, and really sort of figure out who he is and what his role is on the Flames.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, the last thing I wanted to point out about this game is I was really impressed by the Stajan Bouma-Jones line. I thought that of all the lines, they might have looked the best that night. I mean, you know, Boma's just coming back from an injury. He hasn't played that many games. Jones has been up and down this season. We've seen some really good play from Jones, and then he's just kind of faded back into being, you know, a depth player. And Stajan has never really met his potential here in Calgary. So I thought it was really good that that line was starting to take off and was doing some really good things.
Well, the Flames have basically since November have been the Johnny Gaudreau and defense show. And the Flames, you can't have a protracted winning streak if you're only getting offense from like five players. So if that Bouma stage in Jones line and the other lines can start chipping in, they don't need to all chip in on the same in the same game, but just here and there, that will help take the pressure off, especially if Gaudreau starts going into a little bit of a slump at any point, or the defense stops scoring. You know, if they don't, then the Flames are going to go on a very long losing streak.
And you mentioned the defense, too. We're seeing more defensemen starting to get points. I mean, even in the Edmonton game, we had two goals from the captain. We had an assist from Brody. We had another assist from Brody on the Stajan goal. So we're starting to see more of our defensemen getting points lately. I think I was looking at some stats on this. The first 10 games of the year, they only had 14 points from D. The last six games leading up to the Oilers game, I think they had 36 points from their defensemen. The last 10 games leading up to the Oilers game, they had 36 points from defensemen. So quite a change there.
Yeah. Well, that's what made the Flames successful, was getting that many points from the defense. And that was one of the main reasons why the Flames struggled in the early part of the season. It's just that if they do start to struggle again and go on a cold streak, somebody needs to pick that up. Otherwise, the Flames' offense is just going to be non-existent.
I think, though, after the break the Flames had to come back and play this strong of a game, it was quite good to see, because you often see teams who are, you know, lagging behind and not doing as well after that long break.
Yeah.
And speaking of not doing well, we had the Flames play the Ducks next, and that was here in Calgary. Yeah,
that was the most painful game I've
You and I were at that game. It was a 1-0 Ducks win. But I think that's got to be, not even this season, but just as long as I can remember, that had to be the worst Flames performance I can think of.
Yeah, I've been a season ticket holder for 10 years, and I've been to most of the games, and that was by far the worst game I've ever watched live. And yeah, I can't remember too many other games that were on par. There was only 34 shots in the game for both sides.
And even though I thought the Ducks played a better game, you could tell that they were sort of, I don't want to say saving themselves, but they were playing just that much better than Calgary. I wouldn't even say they were playing at, you know, full strength or full speed.
Oh, no. If it was any other team going up against the Ducks, that the score was probably going to be 5-1. It's just Calgary couldn't get through their trap. And they just didn't have the size to push through the opposition, and got handled quite effectively by Boudreaux. And
well, and I think even if it was Calgary, I mean, under normal circumstances, that should not have been a 1-0 game. You know, it probably should have been a four goal performance by the Ducks the way they played. But we have to really give credit to Ramo on that one, and it looked like he was channeling his inner Kiprusoff.
Yeah, no, he played well. He made quite a few excellent saves. I just don't see how Anaheim does anything if they make the postseason this year. If that's how they're playing. They just, whatever magic they had last year, reaching the conference finals, I just don't see it. And like, if Calgary does face them in the first round, they will probably eliminate the Flames, but if they match up against the Kings, I don't even see that being a 5-game series.
Just looking at my notes in this game, I didn't think the Flames managed the puck well at all. There was a lot of turnovers, there's a lot of play, and as you said, they couldn't, you know, deal with what Boudreaux was putting on the ice. We had a hard time getting into the offensive zone, breaking in, and when we did get in, it's like the Flames didn't know what to do.
Yeah. Not a lot of adjustments. If the other team is lining 5 guys up at the blue line, lift it in the air and skate past them. And the Flames didn't really do that at any point with any sustained, like, continuation of doing that. And, yeah, the Flames had, I think, 2 or 3 scoring chances the entire game. Not exactly an excellent performance by the Flames.
No, but I did think for the second game in a row, though, that we did see Sam Bennett stand out. I mean, it was easy to stand out in a game where nobody looked good, but I thought that Bennett was looking really good out there again, just like he did in the Edmonton game, and I think that's important for him to start to see him coming around.
Well, if I recall, he did hit the post in the third period, so that was probably the closest the Flames came at any point in the game.
And the weird decision here, and I know why they did it. I mean, I think one of the reasons that the Flames were having issues in this game was they weren't able to match the physicality of the Ducks, but Bolig was put in the lineup. And for a guy who's missed 12 of the last 13 games, I didn't think that he did anything to help his team. If anything, he was a hindrance on the ice.
Well, the next game against L.A., that he got into a fight with Milan Lucic and lost significantly in that fight. Lucic pretty much handled him. And if you're going up against a guy that's primarily a scorer, and you're the heavyweight tough guy, and you lose badly in a fight, then why are you even on
the team? Well, that's it. Your job is to win those fights. And if you can't do the one thing you're paid to do,
why are you here? I mean, that's not anything, you know, to take anything away from his contributions to this point. It
But even I would even question what his contributions have been to this point. Like, I can't look back at a game this year where I've said, wow, Bolig made some sort of a difference.
Well, he did make more of a difference last season. He's pretty much not contributed much thus far this year. I think he has a couple of goals this season, but that's about it. He's pretty much an interchangeable 13th forward at this point, and I don't know. Moving forward, I don't even know if you'd bring him back.
This is the last year on his... No, he has next year on his deal as well, so you've got two more years. You'd have to buy him out or send him to the farm. He's making 1.3. And if you think of the last guy the Flames really had in that position, the last kind of designated, enforcer was McGrattan. And we know what happened there. They sent him to the farm and he retired. So do you think we might see the same fate from Bolig?
Well, he didn't retire. He got signed by Anaheim. And is in their farm team.
I forgot that.
No.
Yeah, my bad. Yeah. He talked about retiring and then he got signed.
Yeah.
But, they're one of the best heavyweights currently, and he's playing in the AHL. Maybe that's where these guys should be. Maybe we should be sending Bolig down to the AHL and, letting him sort of enforce down there.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I think the designated enforcer guy is going to be no longer a thing moving forward, and... You can see around the league that fighting is pretty much non-existent now, is even compared with last year. I don't think there's been even half as many fights. So, if the Flames end up moving away from Bolig, that's fine. The Flames have a lot of players that can play in the NHL in their organization, both in Stockton and Calgary, so... If you, say, change Bolig out for, say, Drew Shore, would you notice much of a difference? Probably it would be an improvement in terms of on-ice play, not so much on the physicality front.
The only thing I think, though, is if you're bringing Drew Shore up, you don't want him to sit for 12 of, the last 13 games. I think you need, at this point, with the way our roster's made up, is that has to be a veteran guy.
I agree.
Maybe it's a UFA signing, maybe it's, coming through a trade, maybe it's a guy already on our roster who ends up sort of sliding down there, but I don't want to bring a guy like Shore up.
Just I think
to have him,
what you would end
you know,
up
eating
yeah,
popcorn
I think what
most
you'd
nights.
End up doing, like, especially for next season, would be a guy like Mason Raymond would fill that.
That might not be a bad choice,
until his contract's up, and then you find somebody else after that. And
that's where, as much as we talk about bringing youth up, you got to bring the youth up strategically. You don't want to bring a guy up just to sit on the, in the press box.
Yeah, well, like, say the Flames are out of it at the deadline. The Flames could potentially trade 7 or 8 veteran players, but you can't do that all in one shot. So you have to kind of layer the impact, because eventually guys like Monahan and Bennett and Gaudreau will be the leadership, but you need good transition pieces until then.
Yeah,
and you can't just ditch everybody all in one shot, but you still want to get some assets moved as well.
I could also see the Flames going out and looking sort of for this year's version of what I think Curtis Glencross was last year on the deadline, that veteran who might still have a year or two left in him, who didn't get signed, looking for work, and you might be able to sign pretty cheap. Almost like Rafael Diaz a couple of years ago, but the forward version.
Yeah, I could see that.
Someone who doesn't have a contract come August, and it's, hey, come to our camp, earn a spot, you're going to be the 13th forward.
Yeah, I could see that, or even like the Aaron Johnson type guy.
Yeah, very similar. Someone who's a veteran who you're not worried that he's not playing.
Yeah, and if you have to send him to the farm, oh well, that kind of thing.
Yeah, but
you can use him as a leader one way or the other.
Yeah, but a guy whose development curve is over, a guy who's probably already hit his peak and you know what you're getting. It's not like by sitting him on the bench, he's not going to be developing.
Mm-hmm.
The other interesting thing about that game was all the penalties that were handed out at the end of the third period. For the guy, again, that's pretty much paid to fight. The only fight came from Dennis Weidman and Ryan Getzlaff at the end. Getzlaff got 5 for fighting. Dennis Weidman got 5 for fighting. Weidman got 2 for roughing. Kessler got 2 for roughing against Brody. Brody got 2 for roughing against Kessler, and Kessler got a 10-minute misconduct.
Yeah, well, if Kessler didn't fire the puck into the empty net at the end after the game ended, then I think you would have seen an instigator penalty and a fine to the coaching staff, but because Kessler kind of did a dick move there, that's why he got a 10-minute misconduct and everything was fine.
Yeah, it kind of canceled each other out.
Mm-hmm.
The next game we have to talk about is the New Year's Eve game. Usually this is against Montreal, so it's kind of weird that the Kings are in town this year.
Yeah.
Every time I think back to New Year's Eve.
Or even Edmonton, because I think that was who we faced against last year.
Was it? Every time I think about this game historically, though, I always come back to Montreal.
Yeah.
And obviously the Flames didn't do well in this one. We lost 4-1 to the Kings. This was a game, I thought, after the Ducks game, where the Flames really had a chance to rebound and show what they can do in rebounding, and if they can rebound and beat a top team, and they couldn't. And I think very similar, in my opinion, very similar to the Ducks game, the Flames got outworked.
Yeah, and until the third period, and then the Flames did everything that they could to try and come back, but they just couldn't beat quick enough times in order to come back.
Yeah, it was just too little too late at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it really gave me an appreciation of how good the Kings are. I mean, we saw the Kings miss the playoffs last year, but if you look at this team, and I think, you know, with guys like Lucic there, and it was, they're a better team than I think a lot of people, we know they're good, but until you see them play, I didn't have a great appreciation for just how good they are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, they're a very skilled team. I wouldn't actually be shocked if the Kings end up winning the Cup again this year. They don't seem to have any weaknesses on their roster, top to bottom. And they've cleared out a couple of the attitude problems last year with Richards and Stoll. Got rid of them, transitioned, and brought in some new people. So I think that they're a good team, and I think they might end up being a real hard team to knock off in the postseason. Because, like, if you look at the Central Division, all 5 of the teams that are in the playoffs over there, more or less, they're like, even Dallas, who's by far in first, their defense and goaltending is kind of suspect. Chicago, they don't have any depth. Nashville's just there. So I think L.A. has the least weaknesses of any team in the West, so I think that would be my pick to come out of the West.
Yeah. No, I think you might be right. I think that they're going to be the team to beat in the playoffs this year for the West. Looking at this game and looking at positives for the Flames, I thought we saw a really good game from Michael Ferland in this one.
Yeah, he's starting to figure out how to manage his game in its entirety.
2 shots, 2 hits, 1 assist, and he played 18 minutes and 36 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think you're right. We're seeing who Michael Ferland is. He's not just the sort of the kamikaze kid that we saw in the playoffs of let's go and hit anything that moves. He's becoming more of a complete player this year, and it's taken him a bit longer to get noticed because I think he's trying to figure out who he is and play a different type of game, but he was, to me, the most noticeable Flame in this game.
I agree. And he was, once again, against Colorado the next game. And he's been figuring out how to control the chaos, if that makes sense. And the coaching staff is basically instructing him to stand in front of the goalie when he is in the offensive zone and just create havoc that way. And I think that's what he needs to do in order to be successful in the offensive zone, because he is a rather large player, so he can screen the goalie if you're getting point shots directed at net. So if he can kind of be like a Thomas Holmstrom type of player offensively while being a wrecking ball, then he will succeed in becoming a good quality forward for the Flames.
Yeah, and that's the thing I think that he had to work on in his game is he was too much of a wrecking ball in the playoffs. He was just hitting anything that moves, and that's going to really hinder your career because you're going to end up being just sort of like Boley, just the hired gun. And I think, you know, we saw Boma in that role early in his career, and he's transitioned to be a more complete player. And I think now that we're seeing this early from Ferland, it's really going to help steer him in the right direction for the rest of his career, either as a Flame or not as a Flame.
And it's good to see that he's getting the opportunity to work out his game and take a slightly different approach. Like, most teams would have just pigeonholed him as the physical banger fourth line guy like a Matt Martin or a Cal Clutterbuck. But there's a lot more to Ferland's overall game. Now, is he going to develop into a top six forward? I don't know. I don't think so.
But I think he's a bottom six guy, for sure.
But he might be a very good third line player. We just have to wait and see.
You know, I think if I'm going to try and compare him sort of career-wise, the way I think that he's going to develop, I could see him being almost like a less controversial Chris Simon. You saw Chris Simon where he had really good offensive years. He had some years in Colorado where he put up like 34 points. He put up 49 points in Washington 1 year. But he was always pretty much at between that 18 and 30 point range. But he was still the agitator the teams needed. And I mean, there's a lot of incidents that happened with, you probably remember like the Ryan Hallweg incident and the Jarkko Ruutu stuff that happened there. And he was, and the Mike Greer thing, like, he was very controversial, and I think you might see Ferland in the same kind of a camp, where he's still getting offensive numbers, but his primary role is still
to walk
kind of
that
agitator
line.
Role. And you'd mentioned the Colorado game, where he looked good as well, so why don't we chat about that one? That was the big win for the
Interestingly,
Flames.
Interestingly, in the 8 games prior to the Colorado game, only 5 goals were scored by players other than the defense and Johnny Gaudreau.
Doesn't surprise me.
3 of those 5 were directly assisted by either Giordano or Gaudreau himself. So, not a lot of secondary scoring until that game.
And I mean, really, if you look, and, you know, let's just put it out there, Johnny Gaudreau was named the first star in the league for December. In 13 goals, he had 18 points, 12 goals, and 2 hat tricks. So, yeah, he had a dominant month. And I really think that without Gaudreau having that kind of a dominant month, the Flames wouldn't have had the success they had in December.
No. If he wasn't the best player in the NHL in December, the Flames are probably the worst team in the league right now by a handful of points.
And as much as I'm glad that he was there to bail us out, I guess is the right way to say it, to be that guy who got us out of our mess, you can't be a one-trick pony. You can't get all your scoring from one guy. So I'm glad to see now that it's like, okay, we're out of our mess. Now it's time for everybody to contribute, and we're starting to see
that. You remember back a handful of years ago when the team was basically Jerome Iginla, and that was it. And
Jerome Iginla, whatever centerman flavor of the week we brought in to play
with
him.
We had no secondary depth whatsoever. And if Iginla didn't score multiple goals in a game, it was a guaranteed loss. Well, it's the same thing with Gaudreau. If at least that month, where if he didn't go, the Flames didn't win.
For sure.
And you just can't have that. Sure. Like, to have any sustained success, the Flames need to have 12 forwards that can contribute, not even all the time, but at least some of the time.
And I think the Colorado game is the best example of that. If we look at it, the Flames won 4-0. We got a goal from Dougie Hamilton, Josh Juris, Matt Stajan, and Michael Backlund. Mm-hmm. So, like you were saying, a lot of that secondary scoring, it was Juris's 3rd goal of the year, Stajan's 3rd goal of the year, so guys that aren't getting a lot of goals pitching in, Backlund's 5th, and Hamilton's 6th. So, you know, guys that aren't scoring a lot that came up big in that game.
And that goal for Josh Juris, I've known how much like he's struggled this season. It was really nice to see him get a goal in his first game back from being on a healthy scratch. And hopefully that's what he needed in order to like get his game back.
Hopefully
in
that
order.
Kind of ignites him and opens the floodgates.
He had 24 points last year, and I think he has 4 thus far this season. He's a quality player. It just for whatever reason that hasn't been working thus far this year. So hopefully that's just the first of many points for him, and he resets himself moving forward.
And that was Josh Juris drawn back into lineup as Bolig was again drawn out. And I think after losing a fight to Milan Lucic, there's probably a good reason why he was drawn out.
Yeah, honestly, I don't see Bolig returning to the lineup probably until we play Anaheim once again.
You think Bolig and Hiller are both done as Flames for the year?
Possibly. Well, Hiller, he'll play whenever Romo needs a rest, but I don't see him playing any stretch of games like Romo has.
This was an interesting game going into it because the Flames, as we know, tend to struggle on the road, and Colorado tends to struggle at home. So I was interested to see going into this which team would be able to take the advantage. And as much as I'm still a Jerome Iginla fan and I want him to get a 600th goal, I didn't want him to do it against the Flames. As cool as it would be, and by the time we were up 4-0, I almost thought, you know what, let's just get the man his goal and move on. But I'm glad that he didn't get it.
Well, with Calgary being so polite and giving of milestones, I was actually somewhat surprised that the Flames did not surrender a goal to him.
Well, that's what you always tell us. You always tell us how much we give up milestones. And yeah, because of that, I thought, he's going to get it tonight.
And good on Romo for getting his first shutout of the season.
He made some really big saves, especially in the first period there, Romo.
And it was the first time since April 4th last year in the game against the Oilers that the Flames had recorded a shutout. And realistically, the Flames need to have a goaltender performing well enough where he can get an occasional shutout. And that has been something that's lacked all season.
And if you look at Romo, I mean, he's such an interesting story, right? Here's the guy who, we started the year with 3 goalies. Every week you and I said, who's going to get sent down? Who's going to get sent down? All of a sudden, I think, almost out of the blue, Romo's put on waivers and clears waivers and is sent to the farm. And then less than a week later, he's brought back up to the NHL. And he's played fantastic ever since then.
Well, I think he needed a wake-up call to shake out of whatever funk he was in. And like, if you're going to remain an NHL goaltender, you need to play better. And
it's almost like last season when they would bench guys like Weidman and Goudreau, and then they started playing better after
that,
where they scratched them. And you know, I wonder how many GMs now are kicking themselves for not claiming him.
I think like even when Bernier in Toronto, when he was struggling, got put on waivers, and then in the AHL he had like 3 shutouts in a row or something like that. I think teams were kicking themselves for not claiming him then either. So,
well, especially because Ramo's on a 1-year deal. Mm-hmm. I mean, it pretty much became a free rental goalie.
Well, when you're at the time struggling as bad as all the goaltenders were, it made sense that he cleared.
That's true. Yeah, I think you're right. Looking at this game here and some of my notes, I think the big thing that did Colorado in was that they didn't play disciplined hockey.
No,
they took way too many
penalties.
Colorado's
been a bit of a strange team this year. Yeah.
They had 6 penalties that game, as opposed to Calgary's 2. And because of that, I mean, they were playing shorthanded for so much of the game. I'm surprised only one of our goals was a power play goal, but you know, they weren't able to protect the shooting lanes because of that. They were usually down a man. They were not playing the way they should have. And it was just, it's almost like the Flames got in their head somehow, which is weird because there's not much to get in their head with. You know, the Flames aren't the LA Kings or that intimidating, but it was just, it was weird to see them play such undisciplined hockey.
One of the things I was actually concerned about was when in the second period, in the beginning part of the second, the Flames got a couple of really good quality chances, and they missed on them, like that 4-on-1. And I was like, oh, is that going to be the turning point of the game? And then Colorado didn't have a response at all. Like, that should have been the motivating
and it seemed part like every
of the game
time.
Where, okay, they screwed up. They had a chance to put us away, and let's go attack them and get it back. But there wasn't any resistance. And in the third period, Colorado only managed to get one shot on net.
Well, I almost felt like Colorado started to mount an offense at certain points, and then just they did, they'd get penalized again, especially in the first period there. So it's like just they were starting to pick things up, they were down a man. And then they had to start that whole process over again. The one thing I will say that I think is neat in Colorado is they play the Super Mario kind of mushroom sound when you get a mushroom from the original Mario game when the guys come out of the penalty box because now they're back to even strength. So we heard it a lot that night because there's a lot of penalties. But I thought that I think that's kind of a neat touch. It makes it things unique there.
Well, I like when teams do weird things that are not done league wide, like sort of like how
I wouldn't want the Flames to do it because it's their thing.
Yeah, well, sort of like how the Flames, the organist plays like the Legend of Zelda music and whatever other things, and like that's our interesting thing. Colorado, it's that. The LA Kings have Eric Cartman on there yelling "Go Kings, go!" and all that. So it, just interesting to see teams do odd things.
Do you remember in 04 when we were playing against Tampa Bay and Hulk Hogan was there ripping his shirt off in Tampa Bay?
Yeah, I do.
That's one I could do without.
Yeah. Well, didn't his daughter sing the national anthems that year?
I don't know, probably. I've tried to forget most of that.
Yeah.
But, you know, and you're right. It makes them unique, and I thought it's cool. I thought, it's neat. I wouldn't want to see it here, but I thought it was just a fun thing that they do there. So it's always cool to see those different quirks and things that each team does to make them unique. But good to see the Flames not only got a win, but quite a big win without Johnny Gaudreau even on the score sheet.
Mm-hmm.
The points, as we mentioned, Hamilton got a goal, which was unassisted. Juris got a goal assisted by Gio and Brody. Stajan got a goal assisted by Weidman and Juris. And Backlund got a goal assisted by Ferland. So nowhere was Gaudreau or even Monahan on the score sheet. And I think it's good that we can prove to ourselves that we can do that. One thing that I did find interesting here, though, was the way that Yari Hudler was played. Hudler's been struggling, as you know. You and I talked about it before, not on the show, but we talked about it when we were at the Dome before the Anaheim game. I think he's been playing with an injury. He only has one goal in, I think, the last 23 games. He hasn't scored, I don't think, since we played in Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, all the way back in October was the other than that last second goal against Boston where he whacked in a puck on the goal line, that was the only goal he scored since then. He has not looked at all himself.
And if you think about it, it's weird because he's in a contract year, and usually it's the contract year where you see these guys, you know, playing the best hockey, not going into a contract year playing crappy hockey.
Mm-hmm.
And in that game against Colorado, Hudler only played 5 minutes and 26 seconds.
Yeah, and once the Flames were up 4-0, he didn't even play anymore, and I didn't see
him on the ice in the last 10 minutes of the game.
No. And he's not going to be playing in the next game tomorrow either against Tampa Bay.
And I think it's interesting now that the Flames have officially come out and said that he's been sidelined with a day-to-day lower body injury. And I don't know if maybe it's his poor play in Colorado that made them sort of announce that, but I don't think it's a new injury. I think it's something he's been suffering with most of the year.
Well, unless he requires surgery that would basically end his season, I think the Flames should just let him rest until he can go again and be 100%. Like, if it's something that does require a lengthy recovery time, then obviously not. But I don't know.
I think you're right. I think that especially because we want to get some value for him this year because he's probably not coming back next year and we're looking to flip him. I think that you want to rest him until he's ready. Well, bring him back, show him off, and then
Well, even if the Flames, say they do get a stranglehold on second place in the division and you're heading into the playoffs, you're going to want him to be as close to 100% going into that as possible. And whether he is traded or not, he needs to be more of a contributor for this team. And with how he's been playing the last 2 months, he's been more of a hindrance on his line mates than anything. And that's not good for him moving forward or for the Flames this season.
And after the game we saw in Colorado with the young guys really showing that they can win a game without, I wouldn't even say the young guys, the depth guys, let's say, showing they can win a game without, you know, Goudreau scoring and Monahan scoring, maybe it is an opportunity now for the Flames to say, okay, we're going to sit you down. We're going to see what everyone else can do without you in the lineup and go from there. But, yeah, I agree with you. I think it's time. You know, we always use the mantra from last year, always earned, never given. And I think maybe it's time for him to sit down until he earns his way back in the lineup.
Yeah, well, I would just like him to get better, because you don't want to see a player struggling through just because, oh, I want to contribute to the team. Sometimes you have to just say, we know that your heart's in the right place, but just sit for a bit and we'll get along without you for a while until you're ready to come back.
Yeah, and he's not this year. He's not a pivotal player. I mean, he's not a guy that I think we're going to miss all that much. Unfortunately, I wish he was, but I don't think he's going to be a guy that we're going to miss all that much. And maybe, yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe he just needs a couple days to rest and recover.
And if he does respond after he sits for a while and starts playing like himself, then there's absolutely no reason to not try and re-sign him. Or I just don't want to see the Flames ditch him just because he's struggling because of an injury. Like, that's something that's out of his control. Sort of like how Juris, in the middle part of last season, he was struggling with a wrist injury really badly.
But even before we thought he was struggling or knew he was struggling at the beginning of the year, you and I said his time in Calgary is probably over. I mean, based on the rumors we're hearing, he's probably looking for upwards of $4 million next year. We don't have that kind of cash.
Well, six, I think,
six,
was
right.
What.
Yeah, I think he's making four, so he's going to be looking for higher than that.
Yeah, and it's one of those situations that it really depends on what's available and all that, but
we keep seeing that, but really, I think, you know, it's always a matter of that. But I think at this point, if I'm Treliving, I think I'm probably shopping him actively because he's made himself, I think, more expendable by not playing as well. Be it through injury or not, I think he's kind of saying, look, we can get along without this guy.
Yeah.
You know,
I agree.
I don't think maybe they're looking at him saying, this guy's a must-have top.
Well, no. Like, if you're talking, like, say, 5 years from now, you're going to need somebody to replace Hudler in the lineup between now and then, just because that's the nature of things. But,
and I honestly think that once Frolik's healthy, Frolik can be that guy.
Yeah. I just don't know if there's a easy solution between like now and the start of next year to replace him, and I don't know.
But if you think that we're still in a rebuild, I don't think there's a rush to replace him.
True.
If you look at us as a playoff team, then yes, there's a rush to replace him. If you don't, I think that Frolik, who we have in a long-term deal, could evolve into that guy.
I can see that.
And I think that's part of the reason why the Flames probably brought him in and signed him for as long as they did.
Mm-hmm.
So in the absence of Yari Hudler, Mason Raymond will draw back into the lineup, and he's expected to play alongside Sam Bennett and Marcus Granlund when Tampa Bay hits the ice here in the Dome tomorrow night. And, you know, Raymond was a guy you and I kept wanting sent down to the AHL this year, but he's kept his head, for the most part, I'd say, kind of above water. He'll have some really great games and then some not-so-great games, but he hasn't looked as lousy as he did last year.
No, or even early in the season either. He has stepped up his game. He is replaceable, but he is at least been an NHL caliber player. And at times in the last calendar year, he has not.
No, he's definitely replaceable. I mean, he's not a guy looking forward that Treliving and Burke are going to have as a must stay as a Flame guy. But I think, you know, when you look at options like Bolig, he's definitely the better option. And he's looking like an NHL player. It's not like, well, we're paying him, you know, so much money. Let's just put him on the ice. He's at least this year looking like a viable, not like a guy who's making $3.15 million, but I'd say a viable bottom six forward.
Yeah. More or less Blake Como 2.0.
Yeah, he's your I would say your generic bottom six forward. The guy where you build the rest of your team and you slot him in there because he can play NHL hockey.
Pretty much.
Matt, you were looking at some of the stats after this week, now that we've spent the first 45 minutes just talking about the games that were played, and you were noticing that even though the Flames are doing quite well, we're 2 points out of second place in the Pacific, the Flames really, when you look at the stats, are quite near the bottom as well. Do you want to share your findings here?
Yeah, this season is the most crazy season I've ever watched in the 25 years that I've been watching hockey. None of it makes any sense. Like, we're past New Year's, and the Flames are 2 points out of second place home ice in the Pacific Division, yet they only lead Philadelphia and Toronto by 1 point, Edmonton by three, Buffalo by four, and Columbus by five, and that's it for the entire NHL.
Well, if you look, we're third from the bottom in the Western Conference. Like, we have 38 points. We're tied with Winnipeg at 38 points and San Jose at 38 points. And the only team worse than us is Edmonton.
Yeah, and like, none of it makes any sense. Like, if the draft was being held today, the Flames would have the sixth overall pick, yet they win one game and they're in home ice advantage in the playoffs. Like, that just, none of that makes any sense. Like, it's not October.
No,
like, that would make some sense in October, but in January, that's completely insane.
It's been a weird year, and I mean, we've seen it right from the beginning with the Flames slumping as much as they did, Anaheim slumping like they did. You know, you and I have talked about it, but the Coyotes looking as good as they are. It's like the Twilight Zone for the NHL this year.
That poses quite a large problem for not only us, but all the other teams that are in our division and around the league. What direction are these teams going? Like, if the Flames lose three or four games, they'll be in last place. And yet, if they win three or four, they'll be in home ice. Like, none of it makes any sense. Like, especially at the trade deadline, like, if things don't sort themselves out soon, who's going to be the sellers at all? Like,
well, and you might even see GMs who thought they had a great strategy put in place, like the Coyotes, who I think were relying on, I don't want to say tanking, but not playing good hockey and getting a top draft pick. And you might have this GM kind of sitting there going,
"Crap, what
have we done?
Like, we're in a playoff spot. Now, what do we do?"
Well, and I think for their plan, their 5-year plan, that's a bad thing. You know, they don't want a playoff spot. They need those young players to rebuild
with. Yeah, well, like, if you look at the Flames last season, the Flames only had really the one UFA and one prospect that demanded a trade. And those players were dealt. They still ended up getting to the second round of the playoffs. You know, a happy accident. But that wasn't really the plan, per se. And, like, the Flames, if they're still in the rebuild mode, this is not exactly the most preferential place to be in, because they're close enough where not only playoffs a possibility, but home ice is a possibility, and yet also picking, say, first or second or third overall is a distinct possibility. Like, what do you do?
So, I mean, if you look at where we're at now, we've played, as of January 4th, which is when we're recording this, we've played 38 games. We have 18 wins and 18 losses and 38 points. Anaheim is above us at 38 games, and they have 39 points. They're only 1 point above us to move into third place in the Pacific, and Arizona is only 1 point above them. and they've played 38 games as well. So we're one more win, and we're tied, like you said, for second in the Pacific with the Coyotes. That's not a team I was expecting to be talking about in terms of making it into the playoffs.
And realistically, Edmonton, like, once Connor McDavid comes back, they're only 3 points behind us. They're in striking distance as well.
Well, that's the thing. We talk about how terrible Edmonton is, but there's only two teams that are worse than them, and that's Buffalo and Columbus. And they're still within, you know, 4 points, 5 points of making a legitimate run for the Pacific Division.
I know. Like, this playoffs. Whole season, all the normal, insane things that teams would do kind of get thrown out the window entirely.
And you mentioned the trade deadline earlier. I would not be surprised. I mean, we've seen, I think, the quality of trades go down at the deadline over the last couple of years. You see a lot less blockbusters happening, a lot more depth moves.
No, more like the Glenn Cross trade where second, third line guy for a draft pick or two.
And I wouldn't be surprised if the guys, you know, at TSN who do their 16 hours of coverage or whatever it is are standing on their hands doing nothing, sitting on their hands doing nothing this year, because I wouldn't be surprised if we have a lot of GMs who go, I don't know what I should do.
Well,
I'm just going to stand pat with the roster I have. Cause...
Well, like, if you look at the Flame season as it has been, realistically, this team should be like 10 points behind everybody else and at the minimum and be completely irrelevant. And okay, which of the top draft picks are we going to get? And yet, despite playing so poorly for 2 months and at times at towards the end of the month, they're only 2 points out of home ice. Like, none of that makes any sense. Like, anytime any team has 2 months as bad as the Flames' first 2 months this year, that team is not that. They pretty much should be one of the bottom five teams in the league, and so far out of playoffs that you can just mail it in the rest of the year. And yet Calgary, for whatever reason, I don't know, this season's just nuts.
It's been fun to watch as a hockey fan. I mean, usually I only have the time to follow the Flames during the year. I'll be honest, right now I don't have a lot of time to follow all the other teams, but this year I've wanted to follow those storylines because it has been such an interesting year. And I think it'll be interesting to see if it's an anomaly or if we've almost got to such parity in the league under the salary cap. It's taken almost 10 years, but kind of getting to that parity where anything can happen any night.
Yeah, and like, if you look at all the other divisions, it's similarly close. Like, in Toronto's division, that's the only one where there's some separation. Everywhere else, though, it's pretty much like a massive jumble, and it's just very odd. Like, as a hockey fan for 25 years, like, I don't recall any season being even remotely close to this for how bizarre.
No, not that I can think of.
Like, there's not one team in the entire NHL that's truly out of it. Even Buffalo and Columbus, who are out of a playoff spot by 7 points, a winning streak of a handful of games, and they're right back in it.
If they go like Calgary did and do a month and 11 wins in a row at home, they're
just
back
weird.
In. So it'll be interesting to see how the rest of the season shakes out.
Yeah, well, it makes our job a lot more difficult for trying to peg down what's to come, because who knows? Like, this team could easily be in the Matthews/Puljujarvi chase, or they could be hosting whomever for in the first round of the playoffs. And it's so hard to tell at this point.
And as frustrating as it is, because you want your team to make the playoffs, it's fun too to sort of watch that ebb and flow and go, okay, let's start thinking about draft picks. No, cancel that. Think about the playoffs. Okay, start scouting the picks. Cancel
I know.
That.
It's like, what button do you press? Like, you know, especially this year, like, three of the top five players are right wingers. Well, what area do the Flames lack? Right wingers. So, maybe we should lose. But, we're only 2 points out of a playoff spot. How do you reconcile that?
But But even you and I, at the end of November, we're sitting here talking, well, maybe we start profiling some of the top picks in the draft, and then December happened. It's like, nope.
Yeah.
Talking about the wins.
And then the wins, and then some more wins on top of the wins.
And, yeah, it's like, oh, you know, yeah, we're going to do a show introducing people to prospects, but we don't even want to think about that now. You know, you don't want to start talking about, well, what if we're last?
Do you want Lane or Puljujärvi or Matthews? No, we're talking playoffs now. It's like...
But for
those guys again,
we're talking.
Yeah, it's just so
watery,
bizarre.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's nuts.
It'll be neat to see how the season ends up, though.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have to point out that the Flames, as we know, went on a long home winning streak. They won 11 games in a row at home. You and I went to the Ducks game hoping they would make it 12.
See, it was you going to the game that ruined everything.
I don't think so, because I went to the Dallas game that started
it. Yeah, you were there to start it and to finish it.
You might be right. Well, we'll see. I'm going to the Coyotes game this week, so we'll see how that one goes. Maybe they'll start it again.
We'll see.
But the bad thing is I'm going to 3 games this month, so if they start it and then stop it and then start it again, that'd be bad. But the Flames...
Well, we know who to blame then.
There you go. Maybe we'll have a Blame Dan show. Everyone can call in and blame me later in the month. Hopefully not. But up before that game, the Flames, the last time they'd lost in the Dome was October 30th before that Ducks game. They went 11 games in a row, which is a new franchise record. That's the most they've had in the ever, not just Calgary, but Atlanta as well. They've played 36 seasons here in Calgary now, I think. And I think it's, what, 44 total if you look at the years they were in Atlanta?
Yeah.
So that's quite cool that this team, in this kind of year that the NHL's having, as you mentioned, got a new franchise record.
Yeah, the record they broke was in 2006-2007, the year that the Flames lost eventually to the Red Wings. And that was the year where the Flames would basically win every game on home ice and then lose every game on the road. So
yeah, it was a weird year.
Which I think it's kind of an odd parallel this year, because I think the Flames are one of the worst teams on the road this year.
Yeah, they are. But they're winning everything in the Dome, which really, if you think about it, is how it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
You're supposed to, not that you're supposed to lose them all on the road, but you're supposed to do better, I think, at home.
Yeah, as long as you're taking care of stuff on your home ice then, and be passable on the road, then you'll be a successful team. Unfortunately, the Flames haven't got the second part of that yet. And one good thing is that the Flames are playing a lot of games on the road this month. The next 4 are all in the Saddle Dome, but after that, they have like a 2-week break in the Dome, and all the games are on the road. So they will have an opportunity against some not-so-good teams, so maybe they might be able to string some wins together then.
Just like the Edmonton game, where we played a not-so-good team and we saw the Flames get, I don't want to say practice, but we got to see them show us what they have in the special teams department. Maybe going against some weaker teams on the road will help them show us what they can do there.
Mm-hmm.
Matt, I don't know if you remember, but at the beginning of the season, you and I made some predictions about this team for the 2015-2016 season. I thought since we're approaching the halfway point of the years, we're done the 2015 part and we're moving into the 2016, why don't we look at some of those predictions that we made and see how we're doing with them? You and I talked about players we didn't think would be wearing a Flames jersey at the end of the year. We said Mason Raymond and Paul Byron we thought would be gone. And if nothing else, we got Byron right.
Yeah, much to, you know, some concern from the Flames fans out there, especially with how well he's played in Montreal.
But I don't feel like, even though he's played well in Montreal, I don't feel like we miss him in our lineup.
No. And realistically, the Flames need to get bigger. You can only really have one or two small players on a team. And with the Flames having Gaudreau and Hudler and Russell, you can't have too many of those guys. And, like, you look at how we played against both Anaheim and Los Angeles, yeah, you're not going to be able to compete physically with either of those teams. So,
Well, I think the plus side of this, too, is with Byron gone, it opened up a roster spot for Granlund.
True.
You know, he was just the call-up guy last year, and now he's, I would say, you know, he's been up here for how long? He's kind of become a full-time NHLer now. And, you know, I think that was sort of the blessing in disguise of, yeah, Byron's playing well in Montreal, but it's not like we're missing him in the lineup, and it's let us develop another player.
And especially a player that may be a flame for the next 5 or 6 years or more.
Yeah, a guy I could see being a good piece of this team going forward. Raymond is still here.
Yeah.
We talked about it. He's serviceable this year. He's not worth it, what we're paying him, but
he's there. He's doing a decent job of it when he goes out and plays. Not going to blow you away. If the Flames could trade him, they would, but they can't. So at least he's not harming the team.
Yeah, he's not worth, you know, paying a buyout to at this point. He's serviceable. Mm-hmm. You had said, I believe, that you thought the Flames this year were going to acquire another 3-4 defenseman because that's an area they're lacking. They're still lacking there, and they still haven't gone out and done anything. Do you think that's something that we'll still see addressed before the end of the year?
I think that might be a thing that gets addressed at the draft or in the offseason. Like, I could almost see the Flames acquiring a guy like Brian Campbell on July 1st. Just somebody that's okay that can hold the fort for a year. And because you got to figure that Rasmus Anderson and Oliver Shillington are not going to take that long. Like, Anderson's second in the OHL in points for defensemen, and Shillington's playing really well in Stockton. So eventually those guys are going to take spots. So I think the Flames likely will look for a short-term guy to fill that spot for next year.
And putting somebody like Campbell, say, as the partner for Dougie Hamilton could help his development as well. Having that, I think we saw a lot of that with Brody and Gio, sort of having that, you know, veteran guy to help the younger guy.
So I don't see
either that or the Flames go out and they move all their potential UFAs for first round picks and we make another Hamilton deal.
Well, that's also a thing that could happen. It really depends on where the Flames are. Like, I could see them dealing Russell at the deadline just because the Flames are out of it. In which case, then you've got more assets, and so then you can look to address whatever at the draft. And potentially using some of those second and third round picks that are acquired in other deals. Especially, like, if you're looking at, like, acquiring a right winger, because I think that's now the area of greatest need in the organization. I think that would be the thing that would be sought at the draft.
I think you're right. I don't think, I mean, you can bring somebody in who you can put in a 3-4 spot, but as far as a legitimate 3-4 defenseman goes, I agree with you that I think there's going to be some that we have to wait till after the season to see addressed.
You could, like anything, you can go out and get it. If you wanted to, you could go get Sidney Crosby tomorrow. But does it make sense? And there's not anything that makes sense at this point in time to waste an asset just to get somebody to fill in on the 3-4 spot.
The only thing I can think of is that somebody tosses in another deal that we do of, you know, a 5-6 or a 6-7 defenseman, sort of like Russell was when we got him. And the guy just breaks out and makes himself that 3-4 defenseman.
Yeah.
But I don't think the Flames are going to go out and acquire someone for that role.
No.
I think it would be a crap. We traded Russell away. We need somebody. Or maybe it's Nakladol who comes up and earns that role.
Or getting a Schlemko guy off waivers or something.
Yeah, I think I'd probably bring up a guy like Nakladol before I'd acquire a Schlemko guy. But yeah, maybe Nakladol earns that, but I don't think you're going to see the Flames specifically address that need until the offseason. I made the prediction that I thought Smead would come back from his injury, he'd get injured again, and he'd retire from professional hockey. We've seen him come back from his injury. We've seen him play pretty well, even though he's been scratched for a lot of games. And thankfully, that prediction that looks like is not coming true. There's still a lot of season to play, but he looks like he's healthy and back playing NHL hockey.
I'm hoping that the Flames can... I'm hoping that they move a defenseman, because I think that Smead is good enough where he should be in the lineup every game, but unfortunately, the Flames have two of the same guy between him and England, and the Flames are lending more to keeping England in the lineup because he's less of an injury risk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I agree with you. I think that there's a need to move somebody, and I think especially if we look on the farm and say, okay, we've got Nakladol as a fill-in if something bad happens. Either we need to move somebody or, and knock on wood, somebody I think might get a long-term injury still. There's still a lot of hockey to play, and that might end up forcing Smead back in the lineup.
We'll see.
You and I also made some predictions at the beginning of the year about the playoff hopes. You were pretty adamant that you thought this team was going to make the playoffs. I thought that the team might miss the playoffs, and if they didn't miss the playoffs, they'd barely make it in. Like, it would come to the last two or three games of the year, and it might not even be us making it, but it would be other teams sort of losing to get us in there. And the way the season's looking right now, that might happen.
Yeah. Well, I didn't anticipate the Flames having the first 2 months of the season, and I don't think anybody would have. You know, the
Nobody
Flames
did.
Had historically bad goaltending for 2 months. There's nothing you can do about that. So, overall, the team is playing a lot better. Whether they make it or not, who knows? Talk to me in a month, really. It'll be a lot easier to ferret out what exactly this team is. And if they win most of the games this month, which is a possibility due to who we're playing, then I think the Flames have a good chance. If they struggle or even 500, I think they miss.
I think you almost have to take the first month of the season and throw it away because they were so bad. You got to take December and throw it away because they were so good. And you look at the average of the rest of the season, and I think you're right. I think January is really going to be a telling sign as far as how the Flames do and what we really have on this hockey team.
Yeah. Well, realistically, if you look at the schedule, the only games that the Flames play against quality teams are tomorrow against Tampa, next week against Florida, and two games at the end of the month against Dallas and Nashville. So everybody else is kind of in that same boat of mediocrity, like Arizona, San Jose, Edmonton, New Jersey, Columbus, and Carolina. They're all kind of just there. So if the Flames do make hay, then that would be
good.
This
is the month where I think we can say the Flames will set their own destiny. They're not going in saying, we just have to keep our heads above water against the best in the NHL.
Yeah, like if the Flames get fewer than 7 wins out of the 11 games they play, then I think they're pretty much done for the year. Especially because most of February and March are against good teams. So if they're not successful now, I think that you can pretty much cancel playoff aspirations.
Well, we'll see how these go. And speaking of the games ahead, anything else you want to chat about before we get to looking at the games ahead?
No, it's been a good chat on the week that was and the season that has been, and let's look ahead to what's to come.
So as always, we are going to do our weekly predictions game, and our weekly predictions now, we have to thank these guys. They've come aboard this season just recently in December to help us out and support the show, and it's our friends at TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies these sellers so the buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. Download TickTix in the Google Play Store or iOS App Store. Get your tickets and enjoy some home Flames hockey. We got a lot of home Flames hockey coming up. We got
The next four are all here.
Four
so
games, that's
plenty
2 weeks.
Opportunities to go on TickTix and buy some tickets.
So if you haven't been to a Flames game yet this year, I'm fortunate I'm going to 3 of them in January. But it's fun to watch. I mean, even when the team doesn't do well, it's fun to watch. And right now this team's doing well. So go to the Dome, cheer them on, be part of the Sea of Red, and use TickTix. Download it on your Android or iOS phone through the App Store or Google Play Store and get some tickets, and we'll see you at the Dome. So Matt, last week, over our Christmas break, the Flames had 8 points, 4 games available. I predicted four points, but I picked Edmonton and LA as the 4 points instead of Edmonton and Colorado. You thought we'd get 6 points. You picked Edmonton and Colorado, but you also threw LA in there.
Yeah, so you've tied me at last in the standings.
We were sitting at... There you go. And, you know, even our standings this year is like the NHL. We're going up and down and staying where we are, and no one knows what's going to happen.
Yeah, I think we've now been correct a total of 2 times each.
I think so. I'd have to look. So, I mean, the way our stats are being done, for those that don't remember, is if you get the right number of points for the week, the right number of, you know, wins, essentially, you get 1 point. If you get the points and the teams, you get 2 points.
Yeah, I've actually only been right once, and that was the very first week of the season, and I got both the games and the points correct. And ever since then, it's been just, I suck, period.
That's okay. I still love you, man.
Oh, yeah. Great.
Now we know why Matt wanted to take a week off, so he could cry about not being right.
Yes. I have brought shame to my family.
We won't tell your parents. I don't think they listen to the show to know how bad you are.
Yeah.
Somebody did comment on the show a couple weeks ago, the Theo Fleury episode, on the website of firesidechat.ca, and said, we got to keep you away from Vegas because you're terrible at this game.
Well, now you know why I don't gamble. Because every time, you know, especially when money's on the table, no. So... Yeah, no.
Well, it's probably good we didn't put any money on this year, then.
No. I might as well just have paid you right at the start and say, here, you take it. You're done.
There you go. Maybe that's what I'll do next year. If I need some quick cash, I'll just tell you we're betting on it.
Oh, yeah.
So if anyone wants to help Matt pay off his debt, you can PayPal him some money this year so he can save up to pay me next year. Throw it in your bank account, earn some interest, and they'll be ready for me come September.
Yep.
So here we are on January 4th. We got 3 games this week. We're going to record on Tuesday next week after the San Jose game, which means we have the Tampa Bay Lightning coming to town. We have the, it's still weird for me to say, the Arizona Coyotes. I still want to say Phoenix. And on Monday, we have the San Jose Sharks coming to town. 3 games on the table, 6 possible points. What's your prediction, Matt?
Well, considering every time I pick the Flames to do well, they do bad, and every time I pick them to do bad, they do good, I'm going to say 2 points.
2 points. And which two do you think they're going to get?
I will go with San Jose.
We've played some interesting games against San Jose recently.
Yeah. Actually, I'll switch that. I'll make it Arizona. So
2 points against Arizona?
Yeah.
And I'm going to go 4 points. I'm going to go San Jose and Arizona. I think the Lightning right now, I don't think we're going to end up beating the Lightning.
Yeah, we usually have troubles against big goaltenders this season. Every time we've faced one of the larger guys, we've lost badly. So,
and the Lightning are also playing well right now.
Yeah, so between the two, I don't see that one being a good result.
No, I think that if they lose the Lightning, they might bounce back well at home against Arizona. And then having 3 days off, I think they might have just enough rest so they can come out and beat San Jose.
We'll see.
That's my hope.
Yeah.
You and I were talking about this before we came on the air tonight, and Jonathan Drouin wants a trade out of Tampa Bay now. That's come out. He's not the first guy who's won out under the regime of Stevie Yzerman there. So interesting to kind of note that. We put out the question on Twitter, do you think the Flames could put together a package to bring him in? Matt, what do you think? Do you think that, of course, it's always going to depend on the price, but do you think, realistically, we would want to put together the package it would take to bring Drouin in?
Well, interestingly, Tampa probably makes the most sense for a trade anyway. Like, if you look at organizationally, they have 3 good goaltenders, and they have Jonathan Drouin, who's wanting a change. So it would make some sense for the Flames and the Lightning to meet up and figure out something that, like, we could get either Gudelevskis or Vatislavsky back in, along with Drouin, for a whole bunch of things. So it could make some sense.
The only, I guess, the opposition I'd have to that is if you take a look at the roster, I mean, whether you believe so or not, either they're going to have to pay Stamkos a huge amount next year or he's gone.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know about you. I don't think he stays the Lightning next year.
No, I think he's gone. I think they'll trade him at the deadline.
And if that happens, then they're not going to want to take on probably some rent. They might want to take on rental players to get them through the playoffs. They might want to take on a guy like a Hudler and a Russell just to help them get through the playoffs. But I think if they end up moving Stamkos and if they're in a playoff picture, they're going to want a new face for that team. And I think that they'd be looking for some of our guys, a guy like, you know, Monahan. And I
wouldn't deal that.
But I think that if you're going to trade with them, that's what they're going to be looking for. Is they don't want rentals. If anything, if they think they can even re-sign Stamkos, they're going to need to be saving money, so they're not going to want to take on contracts. And if they do move, I think that they're going to be looking for someone to be the next face of the team, which I don't think they'll be able to get through UFA this year. I think it would have to be Stamkos for, you know, a good young player. So, as much as it'd be interesting to see Drouin here, I just can't see the package that realistically would make sense.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd love to say let's give him Hudler and let's give him Russell and, you know, let's take Drouin and a goalie and call it a day, but Yzerman would lose his job if he did that deal.
Yeah. Well, I could see the Flames dealing, say, Backlund and a couple other things. Like, typically when top prospects like that fall out with their clubs, they don't get a lot in return. Like, Nino Niederreiter only returned Cal Clutterbuck in a third round pick. Not exactly special talent, and, you know, Drouin hasn't really stuck at all or generated a lot of offense, so I don't know as if the price itself will be overly high. So it would just depend.
I don't think the price for him necessarily would be high. I just think that the organization is going to want people to overpay because of need that they see in other places.
Yeah. Well, that's why I could see a guy like Backlund being the front runner, like the face of the trade going their way, because he is a quality second, third line center.
So what if you were to do a deal like, say, Backlund and Juris?
Oh, it would cost more than that, but...
But, I mean, as far as, let's say, NHL pieces, and you'd probably throw in a couple mid-level prospects.
Yeah, or a pick or something. Like, say it was Backlund, Granlund, and a second, I think that would be enough value for Tampa to say, okay, sure.
And would you want to do that kind of deal?
If you could work one of the goalies into the deal, then yes.
If it was just Backlund, Granlund, and a second, I think I'd rather dance with the devil I know at that point. Because he's got some issues in his game and potentially some attitude issues, and I don't know that I'd want to bring those in right now.
Yeah, it would depend. Like everything, if the cost makes sense, sure. If it doesn't, no. And
that's what we're trying to figure out, is what cost would make sense, right? I mean, it's, of course, you don't make a trade if the cost doesn't make sense. That's stupid. But it's about figuring out what is that cost that makes sense. And, you know, that's a GM's job, is trying to figure out what cost makes sense. So, you know, I think that's where the Flames have to weigh that. And I think, does Drouin help you now?
Yeah.
I don't think he helps us now more than any other player on our roster does that we'd probably move for him. Does he help us down the road? Maybe, but I'm not convinced either that he's any better than some of the prospects that we've got.
I know, and that's the calculations that you have to make. Like, do you think that Drouin is going to be a really dynamite second-line left winger? If that's the case, then sure, pull the trigger and you'll have Gaudreau and Monahan, Bennett and Drouin, and your top six middle and left are set for the next 10 years. Now it's just a matter of finding some right wingers to play with them and you're good to go. But if not, then there's all sorts of calculations that you have to do. And
I guess when I just look at him, I just go, yeah, he's a big name, and you know, sometimes we get attracted by the big names and the shiny objects and the, you know, guys that were drafted early. But to me, when I look at him, I don't think he's any better than some of the guys we have in the organization. Even though some of them struggled this year, I'd be more apt to give a guy like Poirier a shot over Drouin.
Yeah.
You know, a guy like Klimchuk, I think, you know, should get that shot. To me, neither of them has been bad enough to write them off. They've had a maybe not the best year, especially Poirier, but I don't think you write them off yet.
And especially with Tampa being in town and Jay Feaster being the former Flames GM and now is a consultant with the Lightning, there is a lot of overlap. And like the last time the Flames played the Lightning, the next day the Flames got Kevin Poulin off of them because we needed a goalie. So
that's right, the only trade that we've made
yeah,
so far
during the season. So it's one of those things. There's a good professional rapport between the two teams. I think that I would not be at all surprised if they have a long conversation tomorrow morning.
Or tonight.
And, you know, we'll see. And I could see...
Maybe this is when we cash in our future considerations.
Yeah.
Or we have to give them something else if we do make another trade.
Well, I could see them, if their conversations are fruitful, I could see the trade even being completed after the game or on Wednesday, because I don't think either team plays Wednesday. So it will depend. Like, I think if anything does break out, it will be like right away on Wednesday.
Well, and I think the sign of that, like you said, if it happens, you know, and they wait till after the game, it's going to be you're going to see somebody noticeable who's not in the game, and that's going to be the hint.
Yeah, true enough. Well, Hudler's not playing, so there's that.
And Drouin got reassigned to the A, didn't he? So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if Hudler would be a key piece to that, but, yeah, it'll be interesting to see who's on and who's not and what that might do. I don't know why you wouldn't do it before the game if the guys are here.
Well, you might want to just use them during the game. And
maybe, but that gets tricky too, because then if the guy gets hurt during the game, then the trade gets void, that sort of thing. So I'd almost say if you're not going to sit the guy, like remember when when Sutter made that trade with New York to bring in Alex Kotlik?
Yeah, and he made Jokinen play that game.
Yeah, he made him play even though he knew he was getting traded. It gets too weird if you do it that way. I think if they're in town and the players are here, there's no point not just say, all right, pick up your stuff and walk down the hall. There's New Jersey for you over there, you know? And if Jokinen would have got hurt in that game, would there still have been a trade? Like, I just think if you want to do it, there's no point. It's not like they're halfway across the country. If they're here, there's no point not just pulling the trigger.
We'll see. If there's nothing that breaks out by Wednesday, I think that nothing really well between the two teams. I think,
and I don't even think if there is a trade, it'll be done the evening. I think it'll be done before or during the morning skates. So you can get that guy on the ice with you. I think today's Monday when we record this. I think if a trade happens, we're going to know by noon on Tuesday.
Quite possible. We'll see.
Because you probably want to get that guy on the ice for your skate.
Mm-hmm. We'll see. And the Flames probably make the most sense of any team as a potential trading partner with Tampa, just due to the fact that we're on the opposite sides of the continent and have no overlap, and the professional knowledge between the two teams because of Jay Feaster being our GM before and now with Tampa. So if these two teams are the two that are likeliest to get together for a deal.
We will wait the week and see what happens. Maybe we'll have some new Flames to talk about next week.
We shall see.
Well, Matt, you have a good week, and enjoy these couple games of Flames hockey, and we'll talk to you next Tuesday.
Yeah, thanks for listening, everyone. Have a good week, and see you next week.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.